Clarion Books and Harper Audio present The Windeby Puzzle, History and Story by Lois Lowry. Read by Lois Lowry, Lauren Ezzo, and Andrew Gibson. This is Lois Lowry. A note before we begin. For images and information about the archaeological artifacts, discussion questions, a bibliography, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/pages/the Windeby Puzzle. For my German family, Margaret, Jürgen, Nadine, and Sinue. Part 1. History.
Hold it! Stop the engine!
The heavy machinery fell silent. The operator peered down from the cab.
Why? What's wrong?
Look, we pulled up a leg.
Holy.
The workers fell silent. They stared at the thing dangling from the metal digging claw.
Think it's from a stag?
One asked finally. But they all knew it wasn't an animal's leg. It was human. It was May 1952, on an estate called Windeby in northern Germany. Workmen, using modern cutting equipment, were removing peat from a small bog the day that one of them saw what he thought at first was a large animal bone. It wasn't. It was a human lower leg, and they quickly discovered that their machinery had also brought up a foot and a hand. Thinking they had unearthed a crime scene, they turned off their equipment and summoned the police. A museum curator and his assistants also rushed to the scene. After an examination of what had been found almost 5 feet below the surface of the bog, they explained to the police that this was not an unsolved murder, at least not in the usual sense. These body parts, scientists eventually determined, were around 2,000 years old, from the first century AD, the time now known as the Iron Age. The workmen had uncovered what was known as a bog body, which means just that, a body found buried in a peat bog. Hundreds of them have been discovered over the last two centuries. The oldest is a Danish woman, known to anthropologists as Kulbjerg woman, who died around 8,000 BC. Peat is a curious substance. It's created in wetlands where vegetation, plants, grasses, moss, never fully decays because of a high acid content. This organic semi-decayed material, peat, built up over centuries to become a thick, mucky, and waterlogged swamp or bog. Harvested, compressed, and dried, peat has been used as fuel for countless years. It still is in some places. In earlier days, chunks of peat were dug by hand using spades, then dried and piled beside primitive farmhouses. More recently, sophisticated mechanical equipment does the same job of cutting and compressing the substance. Today, you can find peat moss, a substance harvested from peat, for sale in garden centers along with fertilizer and compost. Adding it to your garden will help the soil retain moisture. At night in a peat bog, gases produced by the bog materials ignite when they encounter oxygen, creating flickering lights that scientists call bioluminescence. Not surprisingly, folklore and ghost stories sometimes portray the phenomena as sinister spirits, beckoning to travelers. No question, peat bogs are spooky, sometimes dangerous places. And as the German peat cutters discovered in 1952, they contain secrets. The high acid content that permeates a peat bog, combined with the climate in Northern Europe, creates an odd kind of refrigerated morgue. Bodies placed in a bog decompose very, very slowly. Although the thick skull remains intact, smaller bones eventually disintegrate, while at the same time, the bog chemicals preserve the skin, hair, and nails. Found centuries later, some of the dead are said to resemble deflated rubber dolls. There are expressions on their faces, and the men have stubble on their chins. Some have trimmed fingernails and hair carefully braided and arranged. Most of the bog bodies, sadly, had died violent deaths. Their remains tell us that. There's evidence of horrific injuries, bashed skulls, nooses around their necks, stab wounds. We don't know why. Were these people criminals, singled out for execution? Or perhaps they may have been sacrificial victims, chosen to assuage the gods, to ensure a better harvest? In the first century AD, Christianity had not yet made its way to Northern Europe. But the people of that era had pagan gods, Votan, Donar, and Nerthus, the Earth Mother, among others, whom they tried to please with rites and rituals. Human sacrifice was occasionally one of those. Young, the anthropologists announced, after studying the body that had been carefully removed from the Windeby bog in 1952. That was rare. Most of the bog bodies found until then had been adults. Adolescent female, they decided. A young girl, maybe 13. Small in stature, they could tell, though most of her lower body had been destroyed by the weight of the peat and the machinery of the peat cutters. She wore no clothes, except a small animal hide around her neck and shoulders, and she had been blindfolded. A strip of cloth, intricately woven to create a pattern of brown, yellow, and red, encircled her head and covered her eyes. She had no wounds, no indications of violence. The expression on her face was serene. Her hair, what remained, was blonde. But mysteriously, the left side of her head had been shaved. The laboratories and museums that contain and study the bog bodies have given them names based on the places where they had been found. Lindau Man and Worsley Man were discovered in England. Toland Man, Grobal Man, and Elling Woman in Denmark. In Ireland, Gallag Man and Klonikoven Man. North Germany had uncovered Dammendorf Man in 1900, and now this slight golden-haired teenager. They called her Windeby Girl. Each of us has a story. I do. You do. My mailman does. So does the frail elderly neighbor, the woman who waits on me at the supermarket, and the boy who just rode past me on a bicycle. Our stories each have a beginning, middle, and eventually an ending. We have adventures along the way. We have moments of anger and despair, times we are bored and distracted, spells of quiet contentment, and other times when we are overwhelmed by joy. We live out our stories in various locations, some of us perhaps, and where we start, without ever having explored other realms. Others find it hard to stay put. Me? I was born on a tropical island. I moved later to a big city, then to a small town, then to another city in a different country, then to another and another and another. I had siblings. Along the way, I was educated. Eventually, I married and had four children. I lived in different kinds of houses, big ones, small ones, old ones, new ones. I had dogs and cats, several horses along the way, and once, briefly, a pet raccoon. A bicycle and another bicycle, and cars and more cars and more. I went back again for more education. I chose a career. My children grew up. One died. I loved and I was loved. I grew old. These facts are not particularly interesting. But when I embellish them with the details that surround each fact and what those details meant, how important they were, then the story is filled out and raises questions and takes on meaning. And the story gradually becomes me. Part of the me is a storyteller. I like to pry open doors and peer into corners and figure out all the whys that make people who they are. When I read for the first time about the Windeby girl, I was consumed with curiosity. Who was this small in stature, middle school age, blonde person? She seemed so like my own young self. I thought back to seventh grade, when in gym class we girls were asked to line up by height. I trudged to the end of the line, knowing that, as always, I was the shortest, the smallest of my classmates. Sure, there were some who were only slightly taller. We shorties giggled, poked at each other, and peered down the line, which grew gradually until at the other end stood the girls I envied, the ones who were already taller and more mature. I would grow, of course. And by the time I was, 15 or so, I was full size and more self-confident. But the Windeby girl never had that chance. Why not? What had happened to her? I began to think about jigsaw puzzles, how one examines each piece, looking for clues of shape and color until things fit together and the entire picture emerges. I wanted to solve the puzzle of this young girl, to learn her story. Some of that story had already been determined by science. Radiocarbon dating is a chemical analysis used to identify the age of organic materials based on their content of the radioisotope carbon-14. The process had been developed in 1946. Willard Libby won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for his contributions to it, and so was newly available when the Windeby girl was found 6 years later. It had revealed that she had lived in the first century AD, the Iron Age, a time when people had begun to fashion swords, saws, scythes, hammers, and farming tools from iron. The Germanic tribes of that period left no writings, no records, so we have to use other sources to find the clues, to begin to understand their lives. And after those sources give out, we can only guess. I started by exploring what facts I could find. Archaeologists have excavated dwellings and villages that existed in that century, and I studied the photographs and drawings, creating in my mind the kind of daily life that... No, wait, I told myself. Before you try to create the life she had lived, she needed a name. I chose one from the long lists of old Germanic female names. I called her Estrild. Then, named, she became real to me. She entered a world that I would create. A world of family, friends, animals, and a daily life that, like every life in every century, would be filled with hardships and delights, struggles and successes. As I envisioned her surroundings, I placed her there in my mind. I could see her standing beside a primitive dwelling with a thatched roof, with forest behind the village, cultivated farmland nearby, and, of course, the dank bog that would eventually be her resting place. She looked at me with blue eyes and raised one hand to smooth back her long blonde hair. I began to write her story. The spring wind was cold, I wrote. Estrild wrapped her shawl around her and fastened it with the curved bone clasp she had created from the skeleton of a bird. I had read, actually, of such a clasp, found with another one of the bog bodies, though not the Windeby girl. But I paused before I could continue. Before I could create a narrative that would invite readers to share Estrild's story, I paused because I found myself terribly sad. Despite what adventures I might give to her, what friends, what girlish laughter I might describe, still, I knew the story would end in tragedy. I glanced over at the book on the table beside me. It was open to the page with her photograph. The small, delicate nose. The lips slightly parted as if she were about to speak. The seashell-like curvature of her ear. No matter what detail...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.